And welcome to the course on Design of Machine Elements 2. So now we have seen in the last presentation some introduction to the unit number 3, rolling contact bearing. So we have discussed about some of the contents of this rolling contact bearings, such as the functions of the bearings, then the terminology related to the rolling contact bearing, and then classification of the rolling contact bearings. Specifically, these bearings are going to carry the different kinds of loads, that is radial load and the thrust loads. So accordingly, there are different types of bearings available. So we have discussed already the deep groove ball bearing. Then the second is the filling notch bearing or maximum capacity bearing, which is shown over here in this diagram. And the third is angular contact bearing. So this angular contact bearing can take radial load as well as it can take some amount of axial load, because the contact is along this particular angle. So because of this, your force is acting in this way. So this will be carrying two forces, one is radial force and another is axial force. And then next is the self-aligning bearing. So in some cases it is required that there should be some misalignment being permitted in the rotation of some machinery. So in that case, we have to make use of self-aligning ball bearing, so that some amount of misalignment, if it is there, it will work properly. Okay. Similarly, there are some ball bearings. So we will now discuss about the rolling bearings. So in case of rolling bearings, or you can say a roller bearings particularly. So in this case, the rolling element was a ball. Now the roller is a rolling element here. So roller is nothing but a cylindrical one. So basically, there are called as cylindrical bearings. So when it is having a particular length and a particular diameter, so like it is specified here, so this is called as actually a cylindrical roller bearing. And when the length of that cylinder is very large compared to the diameter of that roller, so it is called as needle bearing. Okay. While in some cases there are taper rollers also. So roller is having some taper, so one side there is a smaller diameter and other side there is a larger diameter. So in case of a taper roller bearing, we will have a smaller diameter on one side and other is a larger diameter on the other side, and we can have this kind of a roller, taper roller, and this roller is used in this particular bearing, so that is called a taper roller bearing. And in some cases where it is the spherical rollers, so your roller will be having a spherical shape on the top and bottom, and it will be straight over here at the two ends. So this kind of roller, when you are using, it is called a spherical roller bearing. You can see here the spherical roller bearing. Okay. Now some bearings, now you can see here that this taper roller bearing are going to carry the axial as well as radial load, because whatever load will be acting on this bearing, because of this taper, it will be acting like this, inclined. So one will be having a radial force and another will be having a component that is axial force. So both kind of forces will be acting over this particular bearings. And some bearings are specifically designed to carry only axial loads, so that is called as thrust bearings. Okay, so this is what is one of the examples shown for the thrust bearing. And the fourth category of the bearing is the linear bearing. So generally they are used in the machine tool tables, linear bearings. Okay, so they are having some linear motion, like table slides are moving forward and backward in case of lathe machines or milling machines. So linear bearings are used on those machines so that there will be a smooth action, and generally there are rollers are being used there in the linear bearings. So now we will talk about the selection of bearings. So how you are going to select the bearing for a particular application, because each bearing type displays a particular characteristics based on its design, which makes it more or less appropriate for a given application. So the most important factors are whether the type of load acting on that bearing is a low load or it is a medium kind of load acting, radial load is there. So generally, if that kind of condition is there, means low or medium radial loads, if it is there, we are going for the deep groove ball bearing. Then if there is a heavy load and large shaft diameters are there, so for that case we generally use the roller bearings. Well, in some cases we have to carry the radial as well as thrust components. So in that case, you can use the deep groove ball bearing, or you can use angular contact ball bearing, or you can use the spherical or a bearing. These three bearings will take the radial as well as thrust components, but major load will be radial load, while thrust load will be less in these bearings. And also the available space, because how much space is available for mounting the bearing, that has to be taken into consideration. While if there is a medium thrust load, then you have to go for TBB, that is thrust ball bearing. And if there is a heavy thrust load, then you have to go for the cylindrical rotor thrust bearing. And sometimes there is a requirement of misalignment of the shaft and housing. So when misalignment is required to be permitted in the machines, then you have to go for self-aligning ball bearing or spherical roller bearing. Okay, now sometimes the in addition to this, you are going to consider the precision requirement, then the speed at which your bearings are going to run. Okay, so if you need that the bearing should run very quietly, then you should go for the deep groove ball bearing, because they are very less noise will be produced because of by these particular bearings. And if you talk about the stiffness and rigidity, then bearings which are strong in stiffness and rigidity are double row cylindrical roller bearing or taper roller bearing. So these bearings are having good stiffness or having good rigidity. And also we have to consider the axial displacement as one of the parameter of displacement of the bearing. And also you have to see that the bearing should be easily mountable and dismountable. At the same time, one more parameter that is to be considered by selecting the bearing, that is whether the seals are integral with the bearing or you have to provide the external seals. So with this, now we'll go for the different types of bearings available under different categories. So under ball bearing, the different types of bearings which are available are single row deep groove ball bearing, then double row deep groove ball bearing. So sometimes you are using only one row of these balls, and when they are using two rows of a ball, that is called as double row deep groove ball bearing. So in case of angular contact ball bearing also, these two types are available. One is single row angular contact ball bearing and double row angular contact ball bearing. Then in case of roller bearing, we can have the cylindrical roller bearing, taper roller bearing, spherical roller bearing and needle roller bearing. So all these bearings we have already discussed. And in case of thrust bearing, there are available bearings are single row thrust bearing. So in that case, ball can be a rolling element or a roller can also be a rolling element, and double row thrust ball bearing. So in that case also these two different rolling elements can be used. So next is the journal bearing. So in case of journal bearing, there is a solid journal bearing, then split journal bearing, and the ring oiled journal bearing or the plain journal bearing. So actually here our concentration is on the ball and roller bearings only, but not on the journal bearings, like because these bearings we are going to use in the unit number 6. So now we will discuss about the specification of the bearings, how these bearings are being specified. So generally the each anti-friction standard bearings has a specific basic designation which indicates the type of bearing and the other construction features. Like suppose any bearing is specified with certain number like this, like 30208. So generally the first number is indicating the code for which type of bearing it is. So whether there is a taper roller bearing or there is any other type of cylindrical roller bearing or it is a deep groove ball bearing, so accordingly one particular number will be indicated there. First number indicates the code for type of bearing, then second number will be code for OD, that is outer diameter, and the third number will be code for the width series. Okay, so what which is the width series, because bearing is having major dimensions, like the outer diameter, this one is the outer diameter of the bearing. Okay, we have already seen in the previous case also, and there will be inner diameter of this bearing. Okay, and suppose there is a some rolling component here, rolling element is there. So outer diameter is important, inner diameter is important, and the width is important. So first number will be indicating the type of bearing, this indicates type of bearing, then second number indicates the diameter, code for diameter, third number indicates the code for the width series, and last two numbers will be obtained by considering the bore diameter of it, means this is the bore diameter, we generally use as a D. So bore diameter divided by 5, whatever value you will be getting, that value is this much. So suppose if it is 0.8, so 0.8 multiplied by 5 will be equal to 40. So 40 is the bore diameter of that particular bearing. So bearing having bore diameter 40 mm will be indicated by last two digits at 0.8. Okay. And in general, now it can be shown like this, that bearing designation. So first number, second number, and third number, fourth and fifth number, like this. So first number is for the bearing type, second or third number is for the code for dimension series. So for some bearings it is not specifically given for the OD and for the width, so there is maybe a combined number for OD and width of the bearing, and last two digits are definitely fixed for the bore diameter. Okay, like this. So now we will talk about what are the different types of bearings are available, and according to which number, say like this first number, if it is 6 means which particular bearing, if it is 3 means it is which type of bearing. So 6 means deep groove ball bearing, 3 means taper roller bearing, like this. So different types of bearings are specified over here. If the code is 0, it is double row angular contact ball bearing. If it is number 1, first number is indicated as 1, so it is self aligning ball bearing. If the number is 2, it is spherical roller bearing or spherical roller thrust bearing. If the number is 3, it is taper roller bearing. If the number is 4, it is deep groove, double row deep groove ball bearing. And if it is number 5 at the start, it is thrust ball bearing. And if the number is 6 at the start, it is single row deep groove ball bearing. If the number is 7 at the start, it is single row angular contact ball bearing. And if it is a number 8 at the start, it is cylindrical roller thrust bearing. So similarly, few bearings are specified with the letter C at the start. So if it is starting with the C letter, it is carbide toroidal roller bearing. And if it is starting with the letter N, it is cylindrical roller bearing. Sometimes some bearing starts with a like N letter, so it is cylindrical roller bearing. While some bearings start with the QJ, so it is 4 point contact ball bearing. And even some taper roller bearings are also being given as a number. Instead of number 3, they are also specified as a T. So that is taper roller bearing. This is according to the ISO 355-1997, this standard. So we'll just stop here. Thank you very much.